Good morning. Thank you, everybody, for coming to this absolutely packed session. I've got a great panel here with me today. We're going to talk about the Good Friday Agreement 20 years on. I was 10 years old when it happened. Other people here will have been older, and I know that there are some people in the room who are younger than me. So we're going to kick it off in kind of two parts. So I've got John Alderdice with me, Paddy Ashdown with me. John was a former Assembly Speaker and Alliance Party leader, and Paddy was a former Liberal Democrat leader. I'm sure both of them have a lot of very interesting tales and spicy anecdotes for us. Oh, and, yeah, former Northern Ireland.
I thought you were former Northern Ireland.
I've also got Colin Harvey from Queen's University Belfast and Etain Tanham from Trinity College Dublin, who'll be talking about the analysis around the Good Friday Agreement and where we go from here. So I'll let John kick off first.
Thank you very much indeed, and good to be here. A little bit difficult to give the history of Ireland, the development of the Good Friday Agreement, the peace process since then, and Brexit in 5 minutes. But I'll do my very best. I voted for Remain. I've always been pro-European and keen to work with the rest of the European Union. But I grew up in a Northern Ireland where I discovered that the majority of people didn't share my views about most things politically. And what I had to do if I was going to be anyway useful was to try to understand the principles behind the problems and engage with the realities that I faced with other people. Doing that and getting elected was not entirely easy. But I think it held important lessons, both for the development of the peace process, the working of the Northern Ireland Assembly when it was working, and the question of Brexit now. Because I had to address the fact that other people took a completely different perspective from me, and to simply argue with them didn't get very far. As far as Ireland itself is concerned, someone earlier on was mentioning that we have to deal with the history. The history was, of course, that these islands were part of one United Kingdom. And the major part of Ireland decided to leave what was then a far bigger union in many ways than the European Union, because it was leaving the British Empire. But it decided to do so, and it decided to do so for perfectly good reasons. They weren't economic reasons. It was an economic disaster to do it. They were about a sense of independence, being able to make your own decisions about things, not feeling oppressed, and indeed being oppressed, as had historically been the case. And the decision was a perfectly valid one. So it's kind of interesting when people now in Dublin have such difficulty in understanding that people in the rest of these islands might have similar kinds of feelings about another union. And of course, there are all sorts of good political reasons for that, which we may well come upon. But when it came to the question of the Belfast Agreement, we didn't find a resolution by addressing political rules and regulations. We had to accept that our problem was one of disturbed historic relationships, not constitutions, not markets, but relationships in these islands. Between Protestants and Catholics in the north, between Unionists and Nationalists, between people in the north and people in the south, and the third strand between Britain and Ireland. And those who were engaged in those and represented those viewpoints got engaged. And if the people, to be honest, around in Brussels and London and Dublin at the moment had been around 20 years ago in Belfast, we would never have had a Good Friday Agreement. Because nobody would have been sufficiently creative and flexible enough. Everybody would have said, but that's not possible. That doesn't fit in with the rules. That's not the way we do things. And what we did was we confronted the problem of the relationships and said, how can we find ways of working with these that will not be cast iron, copper fastened, gilt edged and absolute, but will work on the basis of practicalities and relationships. In fact, in the whole process of the negotiations, if we focused down on principles and what we wanted, we got nowhere. But if we looked at practicalities, we were able to make progress. Take the whole question of the North-South executive bodies. We would never have got there on the basis of political principle. But when we were able to say to unionists that for more than 50 years there had been the Foyle Fisheries Commission, which had been an executive body that brought together people from both sides of the border because the fish wouldn't recognise the border, and we had to accept that reality. They said, well, that's a practical thing. We'll work with that. Paisley famously accepted it by saying, the cows are Irish, but the people are British. And I think that's the key to finding a way forward in this particular problem. On the political side and the economic side, of course there are difficulties. But let's stop pretending there isn't a border now. Everybody knows who they pay the taxes to, whichever side of the border on. Or knows who they don't pay the taxes to, whichever side of the border they're on. If you're in the police or the Garda Síochána, you know exactly where the border is because you've no right of hot pursuit. If you're a criminal near the border, you know exactly where the border is because the police don't have the right of hot pursuit. The border is there. It's not in people's faces. And they can get on with the practicalities of life. And that's the kind of thing that we should be doing. The biggest economic problem for the Republic of Ireland is not the border. At least not the border with Northern Ireland. It's the amount of trade that goes on between this island and Ireland. Not through Northern Ireland, but mostly through Wales. That is colossal. I find it interesting that there's so little said in public by the government of the Republic of Ireland about that major part of the economic challenge, and so much focus on the north-south thing, when frankly, if we were able to address agriculture and agri-food business and the energy question, the vast majority of the north-south trade would be dealt with. And a good deal of the rest of it's smuggling, and that's part of the culture of the island, and it's not going to go away in the EU or outside the EU. So why is that? Well, I'll tell you what is happening politically in Northern Ireland. A very large number of formerly liberally minded unionists are going one way or t'other. One way is to say, the United Ireland is now inevitable. We might as well just accept that and work towards it. And another, probably at the moment slightly larger number of liberal unionists are saying, you know what's going on is this. The Irish government and Republicans and nationalists see this as an opportunity to leverage Northern Ireland out of the United Kingdom. And therefore we're not going to make the assembly work. And we're not going to address the things that are a real economic problem between the South and Wales and England. We're going to focus on the Northern thing because we think we can use the leverage. Sinn Féin is very clear and honest about it. The Irish government, which is a minority government, faces political problems that it has got to address as well. And therefore, this is the focus of attention. Because very few senior politicians in Ireland will stand up and say, after 100 years of independence, we're still very much dependent on the British economy. It's much easier to stand up politically and say, the problem is unionists and the Brits who won't let the border go away. And I say that to you, not because it's my perspective, but if in London you don't understand that that is the perspective of people on the other side of the water, then you won't understand what's going on and you'll just think they're all mad. And it is all a bit crazy if you think of it in political terms, at least. As a psychiatrist, I take a slightly different perspective. But when people act in that kind of way, it's because they've got very, very strong feelings about what has happened for them and to them. And however bad things are at the moment, never forget, people aren't being killed. And don't believe those who say that the mishandling of this is going to lead to a return of the troubles. The troubles were not created by the border. The border was an outcome of the bad relationships that had been there before that. What we've got to do is keep working on the relationships, whatever borders we have or don't have. And that's not just a problem for Brexit and the border in Ireland. That's a problem for every border in Europe at the moment. And that's the challenge all of us have to face, those of us who are pro-Europeans and don't want to see the European project dissolve into chaos. A very real danger. Thank you.
John, can I just ask John a very quick question? Does anybody know the answer to this question? What are the circumstances in which there would have to be a referendum amongst the Irish people? I know it's the provisions are contained in the Good Friday Agreement, and I believe it is the case that it can be called by either side asking for one, or indeed if Northern Ireland is brought into complete dysfunctionality and ungovernability. Is that not the case?
It's the case, really, that in terms of a referendum on the border, it would be in Northern Ireland.
Exactly, yeah.
And the second thing is, it's the Secretary of State that can call it.
Nobody else.
But the Secretary of State calls it in a situation where she believes, or he believes, that there has been a change where it would be. Once it is called, it cannot then be recalled for a number of years after that.
Yeah.
So you don't get the Scottish situation of, well, let's have a referendum every 2 or 3 years.
Okay, thank you, John. John complained about being in a minority in Northern Ireland. Join the bloody club. It was Oscar Wilde who once said that in a democracy, the minority is always right. This has given me much comfort for 40 years as a liberal in Britain, I can tell you. But I'm not only a liberal and have worked with John on many occasions, and I have a great admiration for him. I'm also a Northern Irishman, and proudly so. I don't sound like it. The paddy, by the way, comes from the fact that I had a broad Northern Irish accent when I went to school, and my father sent me to school in England. It was drummed out of me, and I'm sad about that, but as you shall see in a moment, I can stick it on when I need to. So I was brought up in the North. My family has Northern roots, and we'll come back to that in a second. And perhaps worse than that, it was my miserable and baleful lot to have to serve as a soldier on the streets of my home city. Indeed, I was one of the first soldiers to be sent in there in 1969 and 1970. One of the reasons why, probably amongst the greatest, that I gave up the profession of soldiering was because I found that such a miserable experience. Not least because, I have to say, many of my having fought in internal security situations in the Far East and the Middle East, I suddenly found that the colonial attitudes that we had been exercising abroad were still being exercised in Belfast, and I was pretty cross and angry about it. However, that's a different tale, except just to give you the background, and it's important because it comes onto something I want to say in a minute. So during the Good Friday Agreement, you remember there was a referendum, and Tony Blair, then the Prime Minister, rang me one day and said, look, Paddy, William Hague, I'm sure I can be indiscreet on this occasion this far on. William Hague, the then Tory leader, is going out to try and persuade the Northern Irish to vote for the Good Friday Agreement. And he rightly saw two things. One was that Mr. Hague, for all his other great qualities, and I have a strong admiration for him in many things, would nevertheless be regarded on the streets of Belfast as an English toff. And he said, you've got some credibility there, you've got some roots there, why don't you go out and do a little tour around Northern Ireland arguing in favour of the Good Friday Agreement. I said to him, I don't think this is going to work. The word thrawn is one well understood in Northern Ireland. It is a, I think, a Lowland Scots term originally, but it means just bloody-minded and obstinate. And these people are not best, my people, our people, are not best to respond to being told by others what to do. However, he asked me to do it. You don't say to your Prime Minister, I won't do something if it is his judgment that it'll help towards peace. So here I am, tramping around Northern Ireland in the eve of the referendum, and I'm walking up the Shankill Road, and I bump into a little Protestant, and I said to him, I do hope you're going to vote for the Good Friday Agreement. And he said to me, the Good Friday Agreement? The Good Friday Agreement? He said, I've just got two words for that. Ridiculous. which is very Northern Ireland. And then I went to see the Flanagan, the chief constable, another good Belfast man, and I said to him, you know, I can't understand why the Protestants aren't going for this, because the democratic, the demographic movement to history is in favour of the Catholic population in Northern Ireland, and we'll return to that in a minute. So why don't they do it? And he gave me Ronnie Flanagan, he said to me, you know the story about the two Ulstermen walking up the street, and one says to the other, I like your coat, and the other one says, well, I'll give it to you. And the first one says, I'll not have it if you give it to me. Which, by the way, is just about the definition of thrawn. So you're in a situation which is, there's long-held passions, and there is blood, and it takes a long time, as I discovered in Bosnia, to work blood and violence out of the system, whatever you do, to create the structures that can lead to peace. Actually, the ingredients of war lie in the human heart and in the human soul, and they take a long time to lead your way. And so I think the Good Friday Agreement has produced something close to a miracle. Of course, it didn't produce it overnight, but it produced a context in which that blood, that sense of violence, those vengeances could be leaked away out of the system. And although there are some recidivists, as we know, on both sides who would wish to prolong that, that is no longer, thanks to the context of the Good Friday Agreement, the overwhelming view of the population of Northern Ireland, and that is the greatest barrier we have towards a return to violence. Although that is not impossible, it is unlikely. So now I want to talk about something which probably we have not addressed, and it's perhaps too little understood as well. And John used the phrase liberal unionists. And for those who have a prejudiced view of Northern Ireland, there are such things as liberal unionists, many, many of them, and they're very good people. And they include my family. And I tell you this little sort of family story because I think it is relevant to the point we just touched on. My grandfather was the cattle auctioneer of the little town of Rathfryland on the hill in the Mourne Mountains. And he was a profound and committed unionist. He actually was a signatory on the Ulster Declaration. But he was also an All-Ireland man. And my mum was too. My mum was profoundly committed to the concept of All-Ireland. And what I mean All-Ireland, that culturally, although they were unionists, culturally and in their life view, their concept, they regarded themselves as part of the island, the whole of the island of Ireland, and inheritors of the great Irish traditions. And when my mother, who loved the arts, wanted to go to the theatre, she would as often take her lead from the Abbey Theatre in Dublin as for any theatre in Belfast. And my grandfather, powerful unionist though he was, regarded the greatest poet in the world as W.B. Yeats, and my mother was very close to Louis MacNeice. And it's that concept of having this dual ability, this dual sense of identity. By the way, it's my view that in the modern world, if you force people to a mono-identity, if you say you cannot cheer for the West England Indians at the test match, you are marching towards conflict. And what the Good Friday Agreement has given us, and why it's so valuable, I think, to unionists, liberal unionists, as well as the others, is that concept of being a Northern Irishman and having part of the great culture, tradition, and identity of all Ireland has been possible again. And in the process, the concept of Ireland after that terrible beauty was born, in the words of Yeats, that what was happening in the South was so pernicious, so evil, so threatening, that too has been leached away. So that the liberal unionist in Northern Ireland is faced with rather a difficult dilemma. And the dilemma is, which would I prefer, to retain that capacity for dual identity, and to which would I prefer not to see, the ability to be part of the island of Ireland and in the European Union, or the ability to be out of the European Union and retain my identity with the United Kingdom. And I think there are a growing number of liberal unionists who, now that Ireland, the government of Ireland, the island of Ireland, the Irish government, is far less threatening than was the case when I was a soldier on the streets of Belfast, opens up a very interesting possibility. And as you see the demographic shift now occurring in Northern Ireland, very evident in the polls, of the nationalist vote in numerical terms growing, and this sense of liberal unionists less certain in their commitment to Ulster and England and Britain, if it means leaving the European Union, I think we're coming to the ingredients in the future where the presumption that Northern Ireland would always vote to remain in the United Kingdom is at least in question or can be brought into question. I remember, and this is my last words, I remember a year ago, 18 months ago, I remember saying that I thought, and I think it's incredibly, I think it's in increasingly a viable position, that if the unity of the United Kingdom is to be broken in the concept of Brexit, it will not now be broken as a result of Scotland, but stands a greater chance of being broken as a result of the situation in Ireland. And so getting this right is, it seems to me now, important, not just for Britain, not just for the population of Northern Ireland, not just for peace, not just for that that trajectory which leads us towards people having a dual identity and peace, but also indeed to the unity of the United Kingdom itself.
Thank you very much. And now we'll go to Colin, who may or may not do accents as well.
No, I think is answered. Thank you very much for the invitation. And I'd like to commend the UK and a Changing Europe initiative for organizing this wonderfully timely event today. I am leading a project called Brexit Law NI as part of the initiative. We are a collaboration between Queen's University of Belfast, Ulster University, and the Committee on the Administration of Justice. We are on Twitter, Brexit Law NI. We also got a website where you can follow us on Twitter. I'm not on Twitter, but the project is. And we have a website, so check out our website and look at the information that's available there. I'd just like to thank UK and a Changing Europe for organizing the event today. Today really matters for a reason that I don't think has been mentioned already. What happened 20 years ago today? No prizes, right? But the answer to that is the people on the island of Ireland voted for this document 20 years ago today. And that makes today as important as the 10th of April in terms of the history of this process. And I wonder what they'll be saying at an event here in 20 years' time as well. The European Union is in the document. It is textually present there. The European Union informed the thinking that went into the document. And the European Union has made a substantial and material contribution to the peace process. That seems absolutely clear. I just want to make three points today in the 5 minutes that I'll probably overrun. But the first of those three points is that the Good Friday Agreement is a carefully crafted compromise. A carefully crafted compromise. The language of which was designed over decades. For those of you who think it was all done and dusted, there was a lot of thought, careful thought, went into the language in that document, crafted over decades. And as John has said, very much a document based on the idea of relationships and relationships across these islands in the context of common membership of the European Union. And I think that focus on relationships is badly needed again now. Mm-hmm. North-south in terms of the island of Ireland, east-west, and the internal dynamics within Northern Ireland, including a European Union dimension. A carefully crafted document with a focus on relations and relationships. Second, the Good Friday Agreement, which often gets referred to, and I do wonder sometimes if people have spent the time reading the document, right? So, advice for today, read the Good Friday Agreement, is based on institutions, principles, and values. And the values and principles are as important as the institutions. In terms of principles, partnership, equality, mutual respect, and things like the vindication of the human rights of all. And one of the things we've noticed and been slightly concerned about in our project is the continuing lack of detailed focus on the equality and human rights components of Brexit. In terms of institutions, the Northern Ireland Executive and Assembly, the North-South Ministerial Council, the implementation bodies, the British-Irish Council, and the British-Irish Intergovernmental Conference. The point I want to make is this, that those people who were thinking about this in the 1990s and before put in place an architecture within which a unique solution was found. And I think that architecture is going to become increasingly important in the years ahead, not simply in paying lip service to the architecture, but actually using the institutions of the agreement more effectively as they become integrated within the institutions that are going to emerge, the institutions that are going to emerge as a result of the withdrawal agreement and the various implementation and enforcement mechanisms. So read the agreement, and as many others have said, use the agreement as well and its institutions. And many in this room will have heard, for example, the call for a meeting of the British-Irish Intergovernmental Conference as one way to take forward a number of current discussions. Third, in terms of Brexit's impact, again, we know this, Brexit has had a major disrupting and destabilising impact on Northern Ireland. It has reopened the British-Irish sovereignty fracture that the Good Friday Agreement did so much to try and mend and heal. It's a major part of the current disruption, but not the only part of the current disruption. Many of the equality and rights issues, for example, that were promised as part of the Good Friday Agreement remain outstanding and are also a key contributor to the current problems. As other speakers have pointed out, what's been remarkable is that people seem to have forgotten the ingredients that made the Good Friday Agreement work. There's a sense that the fundamentals of that agreement are being abandoned or seriously neglected. But trying to avoid any type of cake analogy, we need to remember the ingredients that were put in place to try and make that work, and we need to revisit them again. We're seeing, and we'll hear from evidence today about the contested concept of consent in Northern Ireland. What's becoming increasingly clear is the rise and rise of the Remain vote in Northern Ireland. And I think there is extreme peril and danger in rendering that Remain vote in Northern Ireland politically and legally meaningless. I think that is a dangerous step to take. The majority of people in Northern Ireland clearly voted to remain, and that has simply increased in the time since. I think it is dangerous indeed to render that meaningless in the current conversation. We're often caricatured, I think, in Northern Ireland, but one of the things that is utterly remarkable about that society are the number of solutions that have emerged to try and address some of the problems. And I think we'll hear later today, it's relatively clear what most people in Northern Ireland want to see as an outcome of these discussions in relation to the border, in relation to the single market, in relation to the customs union and other issues here. The solutions are there. People in Northern Ireland have been remarkable, actually, in coming up with solutions to the difficult problems that are faced. And there's a sense in which, how are we going to give life to those solutions that people in Northern Ireland clearly want? Here, I just want to end by speaking as somebody who has taught constitutional law for a very long time. For those of us in Belfast, there was a feeling that the UK constitution had changed, that the UK constitutionally had become a much more pluralist, differentiated, and decentralized place. So it's been somewhat alarming to see the return to sort of almost pre-1998 rhetoric around constitutionalism. One of the dominant trends within the UK constitution since 1998 has been enhanced pluralism, enhanced differentiation, enhanced decentralization, more and more divergence in recognition of a more pluralist UK. Therefore, thinking about the Good Friday Agreement, another multi-stranded solution is required. Another carefully crafted solution based on principles and institutions that will work. I think the language of the constitutional integrity of the UK is ill-informed and misguided. It doesn't reflect the UK's current and evolving constitution. I think flexible and imaginative legal and political solutions are in fact possible. And as other speakers have said, what marks Northern Ireland out very clearly is, and recall, that Northern Ireland retains the right to remain in the European Union by leaving the UK. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thank you to the organisers, Tiernan Menon, and the UK and the Changing Europe Project for the invitation. I'm going to talk about the British-Irish relationship as well. Everyone has touched upon it. It's very obvious, it's very stressed, and has been increasingly over the past 18 months. And it's very obvious that there's been a reversion to language, as you were talking about constitutional issues, that I haven't heard in decades, really. So that has been, to me, one of the most upsetting issues. So what I'm going to examine is really, very briefly, the core of the British-Irish relationship, the core of the Good Friday Agreement, emphasising the role of the British-Irish relationship in the peace process. So essentially, my argument is, and I think many others would echo it, that the Good Friday Agreement really was a result of the success of the British-Irish relationship over decades, really since the 80s, since the Anglo-Irish Agreement. It was also a reflection of an increasing recognition by the British government that the Irish government had a role and a legitimacy to be involved in helping to resolve the conflict. And that was not accepted. I mean, Lord Alderdice was remembering the Thatcher out, out, out speech. In the mid-83, I'm trying to remember the dates. But that gradually, the British government's position on Irish involvement in conflict resolution and in dealing with the identities crisis, which it also began to accept as the core of the problem, began to evolve. And that relationship very much blossomed and reflected that shift. I'm emphasising the British government partly because some of the speakers today have emphasised the Irish government as well, that, you know, if only essentially from Owen Paterson, who I know might be at the more extreme end, if only they'd be more reasonable and not make such a fuss. So the reason I'm emphasising this shift in British thinking, British government thinking, is because it was very fundamental. It was to be applauded. It is still to be praised. It was a huge shift in concepts of sovereignty. That occurred with Margaret Thatcher, ironically enough, in 1985. With the Anglo-Irish Agreement. That was the first step in recognising through the Anglo-Irish Conference that the Irish government had a role in areas of interest and specific deep interest to the nationalist minority. The emphasis was on identities because the argument was that the British government would protect and represent unionism and the Irish government would protect the interests of the nationalist minority at the time, and that carried on through. The issue is now that that type of thinking seems to have declined. There's a polarisation in the way the Brexit is being looked at and the border. Even when David Cameron announced the referendum, there was no call for the British-Irish Intergovernmental Conference to be used as a consultative body or a venue for the two governments to discuss the implications of Brexit for Northern Ireland and for the whole totality of the relationship, as John Hume called it, which again was central to the agreement, the three strands, internal relations, cross-border relations, and British-Irish East-West relations, represented by the British-Irish Intergovernmental Conference and the British-Irish Council. All of that seemed to decline, wasn't used, and that, my argument is the core weakness. And to an extent, I agree, where there's political will, yes, problems can be overcome. There were worse problems in many ways in the early 80s with the hunger strikes, with people dying, with really clear physical threats. And it was overcome, but gradually through an intergovernmental process. There has been a weakening, particularly in the current government, in the UK's perception, I would argue, of the need for that process. But also it goes back to the success of the peace process itself. The British-Irish Intergovernmental Conference hasn't met since 2007, I think. I always have to check my dates. So I think there was a complacency because there was peace, because things had worked. And that was on both sides, on the Irish government as well. But it was understandable because there was peace. It was understandable because later there was an economic crisis. Had that continued, perhaps there would have been a venue in which to discuss formally the challenges of Brexit. Because the emphasis of Hume's approach and of Irish government's approach over time, over decades, was that the relationship had to be formalised. The British-Irish cooperative relationship had to be institutional and formalised. It could not rely on goodwill. It could not rely on the power of different personalities. It had to be something that would occur regardless of the crisis and strains. And that echoed the EU model, the European Council, the Council of Ministers, all the institutions that are obliged to meet at periodic intervals, regardless of the issues and the political tensions that exist. The whole point is you have to meet when there are tensions. That logic seems to have been lost. Strand 3, I would argue, has not been implemented as it was envisaged, probably by Hume, who sadly isn't in a position to comment because I think he's sadly missed. And that was the key to achieving cooperation. As I said, in far worse times, it was the institutionalization, the legality, the formality of the relationship which ensured cooperation would increase, leading to eventually the Good Friday Agreement. So I would concur with what Colin has said. There is a need for that formal legal basis to be emphasized once more. There was a need for it never really to have declined, but it is understandable why it did. And just to reiterate, I read the Good Friday Agreement recently as well, having not read it in years and years. And there has been an argument, which I think I may have heard Taoiseach Leo Varadkar saying, that the conference was really for non-devolved policy issues. And since policing was devolved, for example, and many policy issues, it no longer has a role. However, on reading it, the conference will bring together the British and Irish governments to promote bilateral cooperation at all levels on all matters of mutual interest. Yes, within the competence of both governments, it says that, but clearly Brexit is such a large potential and actual crisis. It is an area of interest which just, to me, circumvents the issue of devolved versus non-devolved. If there was political will to define it that way, it's a broad article on the conference, and it should have been used to deal with Brexit and could be used again. The problem is, however, the political sensitivity of this conference now to unionists. It too has become polarized. Sinn Féin tends to go for it, saying we must use it, seeing it as potentially a political football to achieve a united Ireland because there's an Irish voice. And unionists, similarly, who had signed up to it, who agreed to it, I think for them now it's more sensitive as well because its use declined. Had it been under the radar being used, that problem may have been prevented. So it is sensitive which institutions should be used, how the relationship should develop going forward. I'm very aware of that sensitivity diplomatically now because everything is so polarized. But the basic argument I'd make is the relationship must be formalized, must be institutionalized. Meeting once a year is not enough in a formal venue. Those meetings need to be regular, at least 6 months, ideally more. But of course, there we have the political will issue, catch-22. Would a British government, especially at the moment, have the will, have the time, have the resources, and going forward with Brexit, particularly have the time and resources to deal with Ireland? Because it does not seem to recognise how important it is, not as an economic issue, the border, but a political issue where it has really revived the sensitivity and the insecurity and political status of the border, not about economics, but about identity. So thank you.
I'll just pick up on a few things before we open to the floor. Just quickly wanted to pick up on Colin's point, which I thought was very important about pluralism. I think you had some thoughts.
Yeah, I mean, I think Colin has really revealed something which I hadn't thought of before, to be honest, and it revealed it very starkly, and it comes out in Northern Ireland. I'm questioning myself as to why I am, you know, concerned about Brexit, worried about Brexit, and suddenly I realise why I'm angry about Brexit. It is because, whether they mean it or not, and most of them probably don't, it is a direct attack on the concept of pluralism that we've been working towards for so many years in Britain. I don't say that is its intent, but that is its effect. And you can see, by the way, in British society too, that is its effect, that all of those steps towards the pluralistic society, of which, by the way, this great city is a classic example, seem to me to be now, have at least be living, as it were, within a context which works against that rather than for it because of the emotion stirred up by Brexit. I just think that's an extraordinary concept, but particularly powerfully illuminated through Northern Ireland.
Did you want to come back on that?
Yeah. I think sometimes we can get so wrapped up in the issues of Brexit that we don't see it in a wider context. This move away from pluralism is not an issue of these islands. It's a global problem. The rise of racism, of xenophobia, of antagonisms of an enormous kind is clear in absolutely every country across the world, not just in this country. And those dynamics, those are very powerful, and we could talk a lot about those dynamics. I don't want to do that because it takes us away from the specifics here. But I think we've got to recognise that and see this as a subset rather than a cause. We have a political problem, and the political problem of the Good Friday Agreement is that for unionists, it was a settlement. For nationalists, and particularly for Republicans, it was part of a process to achieve further movement forward. So when unionists see Sinn Féin pulling out of the Assembly and bringing it down, they say, ha-ha, that's what we knew all along. They had no intention of making the thing work. They simply wanted to ratchet us forward, pull the thing down, and then say, let's have another compromise agreement in which we will have pulled you forward for it. That's the unionist perspective on it. And there's no point in pretending otherwise. And the result of that is that unionists will split and fragment three ways. There will be those who will say, well, game's up, it's United Ireland, and we'll accept that, and we'll be happy to do all the things Paddy describes. Others who will say, we're going to fight the bit out because we're that sort of people. And others who will say, we'll leave. We'll go back to, not mostly to England, actually. They don't like English people. They like the Scots. And they are Scots. And that goes back long before England was England. The relationship between the northern part of Ireland and the southern part of Scotland was very strong. The point about that is not that that can't happen peacefully. It can happen peacefully. But let's not pretend it's going to happen by some kind of Good Friday Agreement Mark II, because that's not where people are at. And it's perfectly legitimate for nationalists and Republicans to use the political process to try to create a united Ireland. That's the whole point of the agreement, was to say to people, you have the absolute right to do that, but not the right to use weapons to do it. So all that they're doing is following through that fundamental principle. But I think you'd be very foolish if you expected that unionists in general would say, ah, well, there you are, very good, well done, congratulations, you won. That's not what the outcome is going to be. And we have to face that rather tough reality that it's not going to be an agreed outcome if we move down that road, which is most likely the road we are actually moving down.
Yeah.
Just two things. First thing is just that the Good Friday Agreement remains fundamental, but as being clear, I think, in the panel's contribution, it's been underutilised or underused. I think we need to make use of the Good Friday Agreement principles and values and institutions more effectively, and that simply hasn't happened. I think that it's easy, right? If the fundamentals, if the constitutional fundamentals of the peace process in Northern Ireland are respected, then you have a chance for sustainable and stable government there. If they're not, it won't work. And a second thing to underline is, what I'm saying is this, and it relates to the rather bizarre conversation around the protocol on Northern Ireland, Ireland, otherwise known as the backstop. Or a backstop, or the backstop, right? Backstop, is that a unique solution for Northern Ireland, I would say, can be carefully crafted and would actually be perfectly in tune with the major trends in the UK constitution of the last 20 years.
Thank you, Ray.
Hi, so I think I'm reiterating again what Colin has said. We seem to have lined up a similar approach. But I think to emphasise again that you can have that sort of unique situation with political will, and that, again, that's been done before. But again, I'd emphasise through the institutions and, as Colin has said, through using the Good Friday Agreement institutions in its entirety more fully. And a second thing which I wanted to say is there's also, this isn't just about Brexit, it's about restoring the executive as well. There's a sort of different approach being used, I would argue, since the Good Friday Agreement, which has emphasised that now there's devolution, the parties can run their own affairs. This is what they wanted, let them do it. So the idea of a kinship state, of two states managing things or creating incentives and disincentives for the parties, has really vanished. And the relevance to Brexit is to do with the British Irish Intergovernmental Conference, that yes, there would be opposition or sensitivities to using it, but in the past, that was dealt with by British and Irish governments. So there was opposition to many things from unionists, particularly to do with the peace process, not liberal unionists, but from more extreme unionists. The British and Irish governments had a joined up approach to that and held firm. That also seems to be what's missing, not just about Brexit, but the conference itself, and also the executive, that sort of joined thinking, firm sort of framing of the context is missing.
We'll go to questions now. We've got some people around here helping me with mics, and if you keep them short, we can get more questions in the last 10 minutes.
Thank you. You will realize from my accent that neither British or Irish. So I'm the outsider, and I watch the discussion with great interest. My interest is Brexit. My question is, beyond the famous and important Good Friday Agreement, is there anything which go towards Easter agreement? You stay with Good Friday. Nothing beyond that? So my question is the following. Paddy, I'm talking about Easter, going from Good Friday to Easter.
Easter has a specific meaning in Ireland.
Yeah. Now, my question is the following. Yeah. Looking as an outsider, the history of Ireland, their affinities, historical, cultural, ethnical, between North and South. Are these affinities weaker than the affinities between North and South Korea? And we will see the reunification of South and East Korea earlier than the reunification of Ireland? I'm the outside.
Could I just press Colin a little. What do you think, Colin, of the view from Arthur Hockey, which just was published yesterday, that in fact, if there is an attempt to have Northern Ireland having a special relationship in the customs union and single market, that would in fact be a breach of the agreement, as it would violate the principle of consent and would mean that Northern Ireland would effectively be run by Dublin and the EU, and the MPs would have no real role. Unless there was no doubt a referendum about it. And could you just flesh out then a little bit, as you will disagree with that view, how a new relationship might actually be crafted that is compatible, when clearly that's in dispute? And finally, is there any chance of anything happening at all until there's some clarity over Brexit? Because clearly the British government aren't interested in moving anything in the island of Ireland until that happens.
Hello. I wondered whether you thought that the Good Friday Agreement was called Sunningdale for slow learners, and this was because the British and Irish governments managed to negotiate Sunningdale in 1973 and reach a power-sharing agreement for Northern Ireland. Does that suggest that the EU hasn't been such a positive influence on the negotiations, that actually British and Irish politicians have been able to negotiate themselves that kind of accommodation? And secondly, I was going to ask whether predictions of a united Ireland or threats of a united Ireland are actually conducive to restoring devolution and the centre ground of Northern Irish politics.
Easter, I was puzzling what you meant. My answer is no. Easter has a specific meaning in Northern Ireland, and I would hold, you know, where I think you may have something, I keep on saying to colleagues that the true battleground of politics is language, and the words that you use are important. And for Irish reasons, which anybody who knows the history of Ireland will know, you've been far better advised to call this the Good Friday Agreement than the Easter Agreement. So I would stick with what it is just at the moment. The second is also no, sir. Look, I've been involved in peacemaking one way or the other around the world, and the important thing to know about steps towards peace is that they're not an event, they're a process. Before you can get people to come to peace, you have to get both sides to acknowledge that the zero-sum game gets them nowhere and that they live in a shared community. Look at how much that... They have a shared destination. And there's a shared interest in getting to that destination. And that means changing people's mindset. And only when the ingredients for a major step towards peace are in place can you achieve that. So Sunningdale was part of that process. And by the way, when you come to make peace, you need all sorts of institutions that help you down the tangled paths that get there. You may not have one institution, you may have three or four. When I was in Bosnia, people said to me, what the hell is the purpose of the OSCE? It's quite difficult to answer that question, by the way. And the answer is, it's one path down which peace can be pursued. If you think about the resolution of the early conflict between China and America that very nearly led to war, who would have thought that one of the mechanisms by which you would achieve that would be ping pong? So the answer is, in that progress, evolution of the concentrate of the context which gave us the Good Friday Agreement, the Sunningdale Agreement was important. But it wasn't the final step. Without it, I doubt we'd have got there. And if it had not been for the context of the European Union, in which both sides could put sublimate, as it were, their nationalistic desires, that wouldn't have happened either. You need all these things, and you can't exclude any of them.
Okay, so just on the point about Sunningdale, I know Brendan O'Leary, who's speaking later today, would argue that it wasn't for slow learners. The Good Friday Agreement wasn't Sunningdale for slow learners, contrary to the quote that I know has become so common. And I think there are key differences. That's exemplifying what I've just been talking about. Sunningdale collapsed because of the Ulster Workers' Council and unionist opposition to Irish involvement at all, but particularly possibly in policing. The lesson of Sunningdale was that you had to hold firm against that kind of opposition, that you could not cave in to unionist opposition, extreme unionist opposition. So it was very different, and I think there are very different agreements and a very different process. So that would be my first point, but it highlights the point I was making earlier. The second point is that within that, the EU was central as well in bringing, so the role of the EU for me compared to Sunningdale in the Good Friday Agreement was, as Lord Ashton has said, it shows the process by which the EU altered the British-Irish diplomatic relationship as well and brought it to that point where it could hold firm. So, thank you.
Sunningdale for slow learners, that was a quote from Seamus Mallon, and he wasn't particularly talking about unionists. He was actually talking about Republicans and the IRA, that they took a long time to recognise it. Don't forget, Sinn Féin was utterly opposed to the European project until it got to the position politically after the Belfast Agreement that if it was going to go for power in the south, then it had to be prepared to accept what was universally popular. The EU in Ireland is to politics what the NHS is in Britain. It's something you cannot possibly criticise. And so newer people in the Republican movement, Mary Lou and others, told Gerry Adams they're going to have to change the policy on that because it simply was going to block them getting any further. So that's the first thing. Second thing is language is extremely important, as Paddy says. Easter in Ireland means the Easter Rising. And by the way, the DUP, which is now the very substantial majority of unionists, not extreme unionists, as they might have been at one stage, they are now the overwhelming majority of unionists, do not call it the Good Friday Agreement. They say it's the Belfast Agreement, which was actually the official title. Why? Because Good Friday meant all sorts of religious things, as the Easter Rising did. Why did it happen at Easter? It happened because of an understanding of human dynamics that if you sacrifice and martyr yourself, you can get to progress on the other side of martyrdom. There's a complexity and a religious dimension to all of these kinds of things as well. So the language is extremely important. And as I say, we're not talking about a minority of extreme unionists when you talk about the DUP now. You're talking about a majority of unionists because there actually, since the Good Friday Agreement, you have to recognise that instead of the broad mass of broadly liberal moderate unionism increasing, what has happened is that the DUP has increased. And when you think about the British and Irish governments forcing something against intractable unionism, then don't expect that they're going to agree with it. And don't expect that they're not going to use every lever that they can to obstruct it and create problems for it. So don't talk about an agreement with them if what you're talking about is getting the British government to force them. Because unionists never believe the British government represented them. And by the way, if the British government tried to represent only unionists, they'd be criticised by nationalist Republicans in the Irish government and the international community for being one-sided. They try to represent a range of views. Part of the problem at the moment is a Conservative government that is perceived to be representing unionist views more than views in Northern Ireland as a whole. So I think we've got to be realistic about these things, which I'm trying to be, which is to say there is a dynamic, but it's a dynamic that unionists feel is going away from them. Therefore, you would be foolish to expect that they will cooperate happily with that.
That may well be the trajectory, but that's the reality. And you're not going to get a Good Friday Agreement Mark II for precisely that reason. The dynamic is moving away. We just got to accept that those are pieces of reality if we're going to have any kind of sensible outcome.
If Brexit does one thing, it might lead to the resurrection of the Good Friday Agreement. And I think that mightn't be a bad outcome. And I think we need to get back to the principles and values and the institutions of the Good Friday Agreement, because many of the answers and solutions are there. It was already thinking about things in multi-stranded ways. Look, the agreement and subsequent agreements, in relation to Brian's point, are not internal Northern Ireland solutions, or actually internal UK solutions. They're based on relationships around these islands. The sort of unique solution that's envisaged in the protocol, for example, sees Northern Ireland remaining within the UK. Consent principle in that context relating to departure from the UK. And obviously on the consent point, a lot of people in Northern Ireland will continue to point out both that Northern Ireland voted to remain, and the evidence we'll hear later today, there's substantial support, for example, for remaining within the single market and the customs union, which I suppose does raise the question then of testing some of that out, perhaps by a vote in the north and the south again, a bit like the agreement itself. But in relation to that, it is worth looking at some of the evidence. And the point I want to make is that the sort of elements of the protocol that are there, they're being proposed, do not conflict with, but are actually much more in tune with the more pluralist UK that has been evolving in the last 20 years. And that just simply hasn't been getting sufficient attention in the context of the current debates. In terms of just basic facts, the agreement's quite clear in relation to the fact that it is a compromise. And I think I keep stressing that word. It is a compromise that people have the option of leaving the UK, and that is there. And I think there will be a very real and live debate in the months, the weeks, the years ahead about the island of Ireland. And the question, I think we need to, in a sense, change the language. We need to be talking about how we share the island of Ireland together in the years ahead. We need to get back to the focus on the people of the island of Ireland. Yes, trade is important, movement of goods is important, but the focus and the agreement on people, how do we share the island of Ireland in the future? And of course, the big question in terms of values, principles and institutions is going to be, how do we share not the island of Ireland, but these islands in the future? And I suppose the point today, and why the Good Friday Agreement is so significant, is that some of the answers in terms of values, some of the answers in terms of institutions, many of the solutions are already there.
Thanks a lot. I'm aware we've got a lot of other questions, but my speakers have to run off. I'd like to ask everybody to thank all of our panel and the organisers very quickly, and to stick around if you can for the panels later. So thank you, everybody.